So far, we've seen that preparations against external parasites for your pet can kill or repel parasites or block their development. We've also seen that they can come in topical or systemic formulations, but we haven't discussed how on God's green earth this knowledge would ever be more handy to you than the ability to lick your elbow during an alien invasion. In this video, we'll talk about the pros and cons of the different formulations so you can make a well-informed and carefully considered decision when choosing a product. From the topical group, we will focus on spot-ons and colors because the rest, although a cheap alternative, is usually lacking in efficiency, protective duration, and badass factor. From the systemic group, we'll keep tablets because injectables are for veterinarians to play with and they are generally not intended as a preventive measure against external parasites, but only as treatment for certain infestations. Spot-ons are liquid substances applied to a small area of the skin, and much like the totally legit email of the generous Nigerian prince spread all over the globe, the active ingredient spreads over the entire surface of the body. Medicated colors, when put on, work in a similar fashion. The onset of the effect comes sooner with spot-ons, but its duration is longer with colors. That said, both last long enough to spare you the trouble of keeping constant reapplication in mind. Tablets, once ingested, affect the blood of the animal, i.e. the system. Since the active ingredient is not present on the surface, parasites get exposed to the drug when taking a bite. The protective duration of systemics is comparable to topically working spot-ons. Antiparasitic products don't always contain just a single active ingredient. Various, though not all, combinations of the three ways of action with the different formulations are available on the market. If your pet isn't keen on putting anything else but food and a neighbor's garden gnome in its mouth, topicals are easier to use. This also lets you avoid the confusion of what to do in case a pill gets puked back up. Should you just forget about it? About what? Or take a dive and save the half-digested product for another round? Or maybe buy a new one? No way I'm buying a new one. Spot-on use, on the other hand, requires a basic level of precision. If your hands are shaky or your aim is bad, you may end up applying more on the fur than on the skin, lessening the effect. Spot-ons may leave a small greasy patch on the fur, ruining your pet's radiating beauty. The severity of this effect highly depends on the product, hair length, coat color, the amount of dirt on the skin, and on the alignment of Mars with the stock market index. But don't worry, apart from the first few hours after application, these spots are safe to touch. Colors are less messy, but they may have a stronger odor than you fancy. And not all animals are into wearing colors anyway. Look, Priscilla, a color. Take that S&M shit away, you perv. To save your pet from choking in case it gets caught with it in a twig, a fence, or a stray narwhal,
oops,
plenty of colors rip off easily. If your pet takes part in a lot of color-losing activities, using medicated colors will not be the best financial decision. Lacking surface presence, tablets and pills are not at all affected by bathing, and while most topicals are pretty water-resistant as well under normal circumstances, if you have a psychological compulsion to bathe your pet every day, you will wash away some of the protection. Some colors are toxic to the natural water fauna, making summer swims in the lake ill-advised. Repellency, our first line of defense, is only provided by topicals. The biggest drawback of systemics is that they can only affect parasites once they've taken at least one bite. And bites carry the possibility of transmitting diseases. Does this mean that systemics will not protect your pet at all from catching a disease and dying a horribly gruesome R-rated death, thus scarring you for life? No. Shut up, I'm trying to sleep. In case of systemics that kill, parasites spend less time feeding on the host, resulting in reduced chances of transmitting diseases. But because minimum transmission times are not always clear-cut, repellency is a safer option. However, some topical repellents cannot be used on cats because they are toxic to the species, causing acute neurological signs, possible death, and a sudden increase in your veterinary expenses. Whatever you end up with, always remember that no product can achieve 100% protection. Your veterinarian will help you pick a brand and a specific product and more than willingly sell it to you. Take one, or two, maybe three. But it helps both of you if you know your needs.
I need Brad Pitt.
So ask yourself the following. Where does your pet spend its day? Does it come in contact with other animals? Do you plan to travel abroad with your pet? Is there a specific parasite you want it to be protected from? Is your pet a dog, a cat, or a holy shit? Can you give your pet a pill without becoming permanently disabled? Is your pet able and willing to wear a collar for months? Please kill me. Can you precisely apply a spot on? Do you mind a little transient smudge on your pet's fur? Do you bathe your pet very often? Will you remember to, reapply the product in time? Do you mind if parasites need to bite first to get poisoned? And would you like better protection against diseases spread by parasites? Answering these questions will give a great guide to your vet in choosing the ideal antiparasitic product for you and your pet. Health. It makes you live longer. You see how everyone is happy in this picture? It's marketing psychology. And cut.
I'm getting a divorce next month.
And I really need to take a shit. The technical information in this video was fact-checked by Dr. Ákos Jerzsele, PhD, veterinarian, pharmacologist, Uber warlock. I thank him very much. As much as I thank Ceva for its support.